you've seen some hacker movies in the 90s quite often included a certain scene where you'd have a lovely supervillain style map of the world, and somebody would say something like, "Oh my goodness, the police are intercepting the call." And you see a lovely map and you see a little line working its way across the map. What I would try and do is use some standard Unix tools, Traceroute, which a lot of people who've done system administration will be very, very familiar with. I thought I'd hack up a bit of Python and see what we can see, see if we can get something that looks a little bit like that classic hacker movie scene. We're going to Auckland University in New Zealand. And now we can get up our result and we can see it's hopping from the UK over to America, over to the West Coast of America, and then a massive transoceanic cable all the way into the ocean, winding up in New Zealand. I'd like to talk about the Traceroute command.
And is it as it sounds?
Traces a route, yeah. But actually, there's quite a beautiful little hack here. It's quite a nice way that it's working. So I'd like to explain that, show a few examples, and show you can be a little bit of a tourist using Traceroute. You can learn a bit about how the network is working.
This is the network, the internet, right?
The internet, of course, yes. It works for the whole internet, with some caveats, which I'll explain. So, in theory, we can find the route from anywhere that we've got access to a computer to anywhere else. In theory. Let me draw a few routers, or routers, if you're an American. And let's imagine I'm sitting here. This is my laptop. Some server up here. And there's some kind of network connecting all of these things. And we want to be able to answer the question, which way is the traffic really going? Before we learn about Traceroute, there's another command we need to think about, and that's ping. Ping's a lovely little utility that you use just to test if something's alive, if a bit of network hardware is connected to the network. Written in 1983, it sends out an internet control message, and the message is ICMP echo request. It asks a computer or a router to send back a message saying, "I'm live, I'm working." Okay? So, if we want to check if a particular computer is working, we send out that ping, ICMP echo request, and if it is working, that computer sends back ICMP echo reply. And the ping command gets that back, and you know that you've got a connection to that computer. Now, what we want to know now, not just that this machine here is working and responding to pings, but we also want to know the route. Now, this wasn't actually designed into the internet, this ability. It was hacked in later. Something we need to know about here is what's called time to live. Every internet protocol packet, when it's created, is set up with this flag, time to live. It's as if they've all got a doomsday clock on them. We've got a little counter. Every time the packet goes through a router, that time to live counter decrements by one. So, and there's a very good reason for that, because if your network is misconfigured, you can get what we call a routing loop. So imagine somehow we'd messed up our configuration and traffic that was meant to go to this red router here ends up going around in a circle. And that can happen. Now, once that starts to happen, the traffic's just going to carry on going around in that loop. You've got a big problem, because that's going to fill up your network. So they made this little design choice to have the time to live counter, and when that reaches zero, they just go, "This packet's stuck. It's expired. We're going to throw it away." And this allows a really neat trick. So this was created by Van Jacobsen, one of the great creators of the internet. He's one of the men who made the internet work and helped in the fundamental design of the transmission control protocol. But also, this is just a brilliant contribution, because he realized that this time to live counter could be exploited. Normally, you'd set it very high so that the only reason it would expire is if your packet was stuck in one of these routing loops. But if you cheat a bit, if you set that route, that time to live very, very low, you can set it to 1. So my packet sets off from here, gets to here, the time to live was 1, and the packet is expired. The router then must send back a TTL expired message, which you can get back to your computer, and now you've got a message from this first hop. Go again. Set the time to live to 2. It decrements to 1, decrements again, and now you're going to get a TTL expired from this route here. You're going to find out what your second hop is. Time to live to 3, get a message from this one. Time to live to 4, you get a message from this one. And by sending subsequent packets with different time to lives, you can find out every hop on your journey. Very neat.
That's cool.
It's very cool. There's a little catch, because actually, you're not really getting a route. These are different packets. So if you play with this command enough, sometimes you'll see that in between this packet being sent and this packet being sent, maybe the routes have changed. Sometimes routes change. So sometimes you get something where the second hop is here, but then the third hop is also here because the route originally was like that, and the route was switched to be like that, and the route has changed halfway through your probe. But it's a lovely little hack that can tell you the way packets find their way through a network. What I thought I'd try and do is get a little bit of Python together to sort of try and capture that thing of the packets leaping across the map of the world. So let's just have a look at a basic ping command, which I'm sure most of you have seen before. So I'm going to use universities. There's a very good reason I'm using universities. We don't always have a huge budget, so we tend to have our web server being one machine somewhere in a rack. Other companies, big companies like Google, they're doing something a little more sophisticated. So if I ping my university, Queen Mary University, we're going to get a ping back. But we can also trace route to it. So this is a trace route going from my flat in South London, well, from my ISP, down to Queen Mary University. And we can see in the middle here, it's going through JANET, the Joint Academic Network. A little thing that's happened here, it's gone into the stars. That means some network administrator in the intervening path is blocking our packets. Now, there's a number of reasons that administrators decide, I don't want these ping packets, I don't want these traceroute packets on my network. There used to be an attack called a Smurf attack, where people used ping to cause all kinds of network disruption. But also you might decide, you know what? You don't want external people to know what your interior network wiring looks like. So when we get to these stars, that means the administrator there has taken the decision to block my internet control message protocol, my requests to see inside their network. We'll try a nice long trace route, and we think Sydney University is a good long way away, so we might see something interesting. Each of these lines is one hop of the journey, but there's actually each hop of the journey we've got 3 packets, so we get 3 estimates of the round trip time. So here we can see it's jumped from 52 milliseconds response to 250 milliseconds response, so we can infer that between hop 11 and hop 15 here, it's probably gone across an ocean. And maybe here between hop where it's 250 at hop 17 and here, probably it's gone across another ocean there. So we're getting eventually 360. But I discovered something quite nice here. If I actually go for the web server, so I go to the www.sydney.edu.au, we'll see a little bit of a different story. It stops a lot earlier. It stops here at this Akamai Technologies. I don't know if you know the company Akamai.
Is that like a local copy or something?
Yes, exactly that. Yeah, brilliant. Yeah, that's exactly what it is. A lot of people don't know about them, but these companies like Akamai and Limelight Content, CDN, Content Distribution Content Delivery Networks, most of the traffic you get off the internet, if you're going to YouTube, Netflix, whatever, you aren't going to a single server somewhere in America. You're going to the local copy they've mirrored. And Sydney University has quite sensibly decided, you know what, we're in Australia, we're a long way from a lot of people who are trying to access our website. we'll pay these people a bit of money and they'll put a copy closer. So that's quite an interesting thing we can see. But the other thing I thought I'd do is to turn this into that scene we sometimes see in the hacker movies, or a little bit. So let's look over here at some Python. We can do what we call IP geolocation. Doesn't always work. What we try and do is take an IP address and work out where it is in the world. So here's a little bit of Python code that takes a string that's an internet protocol address. I'm using version 4 because I'm old-fashioned and I'm kind of used to that. But this is taking that string, sending it out to this particular company, getting back a response, and we can parse out of that response that that company gives us a latitude and a longitude. Now, there's no mechanism in the internet that allows that. All they've done is they've got a database and they're saying who owns that IP address. So it's not always perfectly accurate. You get some funny things coming up. Like if the only thing they know is that that company is in America, it will return the latitude and longitude.
The centre.
Yeah, the very geographical dead centre of America. That has some really peculiar effects. People who think they know a little bit more than they actually know, they go, who's the IP address that's annoyed me? I'll find the latitude and longitude and show up there. People who live in that middle address in America, that's in the very middle of America, sometimes find random strangers showing up at their house annoyed with them because they think some company lives there or they think somebody's tried to hack them from there.
Sorry to those people living in that home.
Yeah, it's really unfortunate for them because until IP geolocation was a thing, it was just some address in America. But now it's the very middle of America. It can work out very unhappily for them. So this is the bit of code anyway that takes this string IP address, sends out a request, gets some JSON back, parses that JSON and gets me a lat and long. And I've got some basic error checking. This is not brilliant code. I hacked it together in an hour a couple of nights ago. Now, the other thing I need to do is send out a traceroute command. So here's a Python sending out a traceroute to some IP address that I'm going to pass in from the command line. I'm going to use some basic map plotting, and I'm going to pass through the individual lines of my command line output, split out the IP address on this line here, do some basic parsing to see if it's one of those stars or an error line. And if I have a new latitude and longitude, and if I've got some previous latitude and longitude, I'm going to draw a great circle line. So I'm just calling a library routine here to do it and plot that on the map. So let's have a look at that working to somewhere interesting. So if we go to the sydney.edu.au, it'll take a little bit of time to go through the traceroute command, and we'll see it's working there, sending out those sequences of three packets. And now it's going to pop up the map of the world, and we can see more or less where it's going. So there's one big, great circle hop from London. I suspect that is that middle of America address I told you about.
That's definitely not New York, is it?
No. That's not new. I suspect that all it knows about the server there is it's in America, and that's the middle. I've got a hop out to the west coast there. Looks like it's somewhere in California. And then bang, all the way down to Australia. I think we can also say, look, kink there as it comes in on the coast there and then makes its way down to Sydney for the final bit.
Can we try somewhere random, somewhere different?
UCT.
University of Cape Town.
UCT. Okay, Cape Town. Very nice place. Yeah, I've been there. So now we're doing our route to Cape Town, South Africa. I have no idea what this one will actually look like. Okay, it's going. By the way, I'm always doing the web server because I suspect that the web server will be a single machine on that. Oh, well, that's not as interesting as I'd hoped. We can't see too much. I don't think that's a full great circle, though. I think there's a sort of central hop there. If we hop over to Tokyo, so let's try and get us over to the University of Tokyo, which is in Japan. And again, it's going to pop up the route. We can see when we get the big jump from 27 to 100, that's it jumping over an ocean, that's it jumping over another one.
So it's interesting to me that it tends to go westerly. Is that because of America being a powerhouse in the internet?
You can also find that sometimes different places, even within a country, will swap around. And I have seen this, I'm not going to run it until it doesn't, but I have seen this swap round, and at another time of day, it will take the eastbound route. Blue, cost of one. And nothing else, because we haven't yet switched on green. So now black is switched on. Blue can
which
see
direction the signal is moving in. So the speed of those pulses tell us the rate. We know which direction it is because we know which roller it's coming from, and we can look at the...